Any volunteers?
If we heat the solid,
okay,
the whole solid,
yeah,
then a part of it will be carried by the phonons.
A part of the heat will be carried. Okay. Are you talking about conduction
yes.
here, or are you talking about thermal conductivity by any chance? Right? So you're talking about thermal
conductivity.
Actually,
right? I wanted to say that specific heat will be associated with some heat.
That's correct.
Some heat conduction.
So that is where I wanted to ask you. So as you said, specific heat will be like heat conduction. So do you think a thermal conductivity component is involved here? Because we're talking about two different quantities, isn't it? Specific heat versus thermal conductivity. These are two different quantities.
Yes.
Why are these two different quantities? One, so let me tell you, one is a thermodynamic quantity and the other one is actually a transport quantity. Okay.
Yes.
And the thermodynamic quantity is a quantity that is a property of equilibrium. Correct?
Yes. Yes.
And the thermal conductivity is a transport phenomenon or is a transport quantity. So it's a property of non-equilibrium. Okay. So there is a very essential difference between the two. Fine?
Yes.
But you are going in the right direction. So there is, so we, if we give some heat to a solid, then what happens? That is the question you are asking. And the answer you gave is that the heat is carried, correct? Instead of saying
yes.
carried, let's change that word and say it is absorbed.
Okay.
Okay. So because that's a property in equilibrium. So let's say we heat the solid and it absorbs the heat, right? And changes its temperature.
Yes.
Now this can happen under varying conditions. It can happen under constant volume. It can happen under constant pressure. Correct? Corresponding
yes.
to these two, we can have CV and CP.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So specific heat is basically the heat required to change the temperature of a substance by 1 degree Kelvin. Okay. So, so was this Shomita?
Sir.
Yeah. So as Shomita said, we give some heat to a solid and the solid absorbs the heat. Okay, so the question is, where does this heat actually go? Okay, and that's where this word or these set of words due to phonons, that's where it comes in, which means that there are certain kinds of excitations in the system which can absorb the heat that you are giving it. So let's say there is a solid in equilibrium, okay. And at equilibrium, there are a certain number of, there is a certain distribution of electrons, there is a certain distribution of phonons and so on. Now, when you give it heat and you raise the temperature, then you're changing the equilibrium conditions. Okay. So, because you're changing the temperature, so the system has to come to a new equilibrium. In that new equilibrium, the distribution of electrons, phonons and everything is going to be different. Okay. Which is when we have to consider that when we supply heat to the system, what are the entities in the system that will absorb the heat? Okay. So phonons are one entity that will absorb the heat, right? Electrons are the second entity that can absorb the heat. So normally when we talk about specific heat, we talk about two different contributions. One is from the phonons and one is from the electrons, which means that how much of that heat is absorbed by the phonons and how much of the heat is absorbed by the electrons. Now there could be other excitations in the system also that can absorb that heat, as you may be aware. So magnons, phonons, plasmons, so not phonons but plasmons and so on. So these are also entities that could be excited, and these entities could also absorb the heat. Okay. So you would in some systems have to calculate the specific heat contribution due to the other entities also. Okay. But what does this specific heat contribution depend on, right? So we have to ask the question, when we supply heat, what is it that will, I mean, or how will the phonons absorb it? Okay, so that's where the distribution of the phonons in different states, that's where it comes in. So when we talked about del E by del T is CV, and CV is the expectation value of the Hamiltonian, right? You can see that this is equivalent to saying that delta E is basically CV delta T. Okay. So what we are doing here is essentially changing the internal energy of the system, okay, when we change the temperature. And how much does the internal energy change depends on the specific heat of the system, right? So in some sense then, the CV should depend on the density of states of the phonons, okay? And if we are giving it some energy, then whether that energy is able to be absorbed by the phonons, that is the question that we should ask, okay? So let's calculate this, and this is what we had calculated in the last class also. But before that, let me ask you a question. Can CV be negative?
Yes, sir.
So can the specific heat be negative?
Yes, sir, that can be.
Okay, give me an example.
In black holes.
Okay, I do not know about black holes, I'm sorry, but I think even I should not say anything. I don't know about black holes, but let's take earthly objects, okay? And on the earth, if we apply statistical mechanics, normal statistical mechanics, classical or quantum, doesn't matter, can the CV be negative? I'll find out about black holes, okay? I don't know that. There is a strong research direction in terms of thermodynamics of black holes, but I'm not sure whether what you said is correct or not, but I'll find out.
Yeah, we did a problem in statistical mechanics, there was this question.
Okay. So I remember that. I see. Yeah. So there you found that the CV of black holes can be negative, is it?
Yeah.
I see. Okay. So, any solid on Earth, can the specific heat be negative?
A two-level system.
Sorry?
Negative temperature is possible.
Actually, can you speak a little bit louder? I'm not able to hear you.
Is it possible for a system with negative temperature can be achieved? Because if you supply heat.
Okay, I'm sorry, I'm not able to hear you properly, but let me tell you the answer. So CV cannot be negative. In fact, if CV is negative, the system should be unstable. And how do you show that? You can show that theoretically by showing that CV is actually proportional to the square of the fluctuation in energy. Okay, so what we are saying is, let's say you consider any system, and this system is in contact with some reservoir. Okay, this is what we consider in statistical mechanics. Okay, so this is an infinite reservoir, and this is at certain temperature T, and because these two are in equilibrium, this is at some temperature T. Okay, now the energy of this system is being exchanged with this particular reservoir, right? But because the energy is not a constant, you will have some fluctuations in energy, and what you can show is actually that CV is proportional to delta E squared, right? So under normal conditions, CV should never be negative, right? But I'm not sure what exactly goes on in black holes because of which it can be negative. Okay, so right, and if we look at for phonons specifically, then the way we started it was doing this, and this is exactly the same route for electrons also, right? The same thing you would do for electrons, for phonons, or for any other object, that you would take the Hamiltonian, okay? Then you would find the expectation value of the Hamiltonian, and then you would take the derivative with respect to the temperature, right? That's when you would get the specific heat. So what did we do? We wrote down the Hamiltonian, and the Hamiltonian for phonons turned out to be this: NKS plus half. So this is something that we had discussed last time, KS, that there are N modes, okay? And then there is a sum over the branches also. So this is a, S is a branch index, and K is the wave vector. So S is the branch index. And just to motivate this, if you remember, for the diatomic chain, we had two branches. One was the acoustic branch and one was the optical branch. So this is optical branch and this was the acoustic branch. And what we would do in this sum is basically S will go over 1 and 2. So 1 is acoustic and 2 is optical. And the omega k, you can see, depends on the branch. For acoustic branches, the omega k will start out by being linear and then will saturate near the Brillouin zone edge. This is pi by a. And for the optical branch, the omega k will start out by being finite and then it's a weak function of the momentum. So this is k. This is one dimension. But in general, if you want to do any three-dimensional or two-dimensional system, you have to find the full dispersion for each branch and then write this out. And remember, this is the number operator. This is a quantum mechanical number operator. And when we take the expectation value of this h hat, basically we will get the expectation value of the number operator. Okay. Now, if we take a derivative of this, del h by del t, then you can see that the constant term will basically drop out. Okay. And all we will have to find out is the derivative of the expectation value of the number operator, right? So CV, which is del H by del T, will just be equal to sum over KS del by del T of N KS times H cross omega KS. And why do we do this? It's because the omega KS are the normal modes and these are not dependent on temperature. Okay, so these are the solution, these are the normal, these are the solution to the these are basically the normal modes and they are not dependent on temperature. It's only the distribution of phonons that depends on the temperature. It's the occupancy of these normal modes that depends on temperature. So that's where the temperature is going in finding the expectation value. And that's why when we take a derivative, then this constant term will drop out and we will only have to take the derivative of the number operator. Okay, so this is where we were last time, and we had also derived this in a certain limit, the high temperature limit. Let me just recapitulate that. Okay, so basically we had set up this problem as follows. So expectation value of E or expectation value of H hat was basically sum over nks e to the power minus nks h cross omega ks times beta divided by sum over e to the power minus nks beta. So this basically comes from expectation value of any operator is given by the trace of a times e to the power minus beta h over trace of e to the power minus beta h. Okay. So this is where it came from. And we started evaluating this and we found out an exact expression for this particular quantity. And what we found was this. We found an exact expression for the specific heat, which was 1 over kBT squared, 1 by volume, sum over ks, h cross omega ks whole squared, e to the power beta h cross omega ks divided by e to the power beta h cross omega ks minus 1 whole squared. Okay, So this, remember, is an exact expression. So starting from that Hamiltonian, this is the exact expression. Okay. Now the thing was, this expression doesn't give us an understanding. Okay. This is, unless you actually plot the CV as a function of temperature, you will not understand how does the specific heat behave. And the reason it's important to understand the dependence on temperature is because the specific heat is an experimentally measurable quantity. So when you measure the specific heat of a certain system, you would want to know what are the entities in the system that are absorbing the heat that you're supplying. Okay. And by understanding the specific heat as found in the experiments, you would be able to predict what is the density of states, for example. Okay. And what are the kind of different things that are going on? Is there a new phenomenon that's happening? For example, in the superconducting transition, the specific heat has a divergence. Okay. So by looking at the divergence, in fact, you can say that there is a superconducting transition that is happening. Okay. It's called a lambda transition. So the presence of the divergence in the specific heat is an extremely important indication of a phase transition, right? And whether the specific heat is linear, exponential, whether it is T cube, or you know, what is the temperature dependence, in fact determines where the heat is actually going. Okay? And that's a very important tool to understand the internal dynamics of any solid, right? So because of that, we have to really understand this expression. And to understand this expression, we had taken a low temperature limit and a high temperature limit. Okay. So the high temperature limit and the low temperature limit, we had to decide, okay, what is it that we are comparing with? When we say high temperature, what is the temperature high with respect to? Right. So we said, let's take the maximum of all phonon energies, okay, and consider a temperature or a thermal energy scale which is much greater than that, right? And when we did this, then we found that the CV was a constant in this limit, right? But when we did the low temperature limit, we could not consider this limit, okay? This is not possible for acoustic phonons. So this is not possible for acoustic phonons because there is no minimum for the phonons if it's the acoustic branch. I mean, the minimum of this is actually zero for acoustic phonons, right? Because the acoustic phonons start from zero energy. And you would really, I mean, there is no temperature which is much smaller than zero, because temperature is also, the minimum temperature is zero. Hence, this is not the correct, form or correct assumption for the low temperature limit. So what we did was we another kind of an approximation called the Debye approximation. But in order to do that, we had to consider the real dispersion of the acoustic phonons. Okay. So what we started out with doing was that omega ks, we considered it to be of the form c times k. So this is a linear approximation for the dispersion. So notice that in the high temperature limit, the dispersion was not important. Whatever the branch is, whether it is acoustic, whether it is optical, and so on, the CV will turn out to be a constant. So all kinds of phonons at very high temperature will absorb equal amounts of energy. Okay? But at low temperatures, that is not true, right? Different kinds of phonons will absorb differently. So you can see that easily from the dispersion itself. If you take this dispersion, which is for the 1D chain, diatomic chain, then you can see that if you supply, for example, this much amount of heat, okay? So remember, this is also the omega ks, but I can choose to supply this much of heat, right? Then I know that roughly the kind of phonons that I'm going to excite will be in this range, right? But then what about these phonons, right? Can I excite these phonons at this energy, right? So the answer is actually yes. you can excite even the phonons which are at very high energies even by supplying very low thermal energy. But the excitation probability of these optical phonons will be exponentially small. Okay, so that is something that will also come out of this particular analysis. So let us see this first for acoustic phonons, and then we will apply this for optical phonons also. Okay, so omega ks is ck is an approximation that we do, and we say that this is linear only at low k, at low wave number. But let approximation to be true even for larger wave number, which means we are extending this. Okay, and until what do we extend, right? Do we extend it all the way to the Brillouin zone edge, or do we extend it to some specific cutoff scale, right? So we can consider a specific cutoff scale and then consider it only up to that wave number, right? So that will be called the Debye wave number. Okay, so are there any questions at this point?
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
That expectation value, we include the branches as well, right?
Is this Disha?
So, yeah.
Disha, can you speak louder, please? It's very hard to comprehend what you're saying.
Am I audible now?
You are audible, but yeah. Can you speak a little bit louder? Maybe closer to the microphone?
Am I audible now?
Yeah, yeah. Tell me.
So we consider the branches as well, right? In the expectation value of...
That's correct.
So when... what I tried doing is I tried quantizing in the case of diatomic lattice. But yeah, there was a coupling term which comes. So
there was
a coupling term.
A coupling of the acoustic and the optical?
So I don't know if I did it in the right way or not. I wasn't able to write it as summation of independent Hamiltonians.
Okay. So they should not actually get coupled if you are only at the harmonic level. Why don't you do one thing? You just send me a note of your calculation. I'll just point out where the flaw is.
Okay.
Yeah. So at the harmonic level, you should find that all the normal modes are completely independent, and the expectation value or the Hamiltonian should just be a pure sum of the different normal mode energies. Okay. So just send me your calculation. I will just point out the flaw. Okay.
Okay.
So yeah. So here also, you can see that the specific heat is actually sum over different branches. Right. So what we are doing is we are calculating the specific heat now corresponding to the acoustic branch, right? And then you can consider the specific heat from the optical branch separately, right? So first let's look at the acoustic branch, where we consider the dispersion to be linear, right? And with this linear dispersion, in fact we had done this also, with this linear dispersion we had found a certain expression for the specific heat, and that expression was this. Cv is kb to the power 4 tq over 2 pi squared h cross c whole cube integral 0 to theta d by t dx x to the power 4 e to the power x over whole square. Okay, so this was the expression we had found. Okay, and I don't think we had done the full algebra, but basically the important thing to remember here is this. The CV, the temperature dependence in the specific heat, comes from two different places. One from here, the temperature dependence is coming from here, and the second temperature dependence is coming from here, right? And what I'm going to claim now is that theta d by t is much greater than 1, right? So I'm going to send this to infinity. Okay, and write this as CV is some number. Okay, let me call that number maybe a small a. Okay, small a, kb to the power 4 tq by 2 pi squared times h cross c whole cube. where this number A is just 0 to infinity dx, x to the power 4, e to the power x over e to the power x minus 1 whole squared. So let's just discuss a little bit about this number first, okay? Yeah? Is there a question? No? Okay. So, see, the way we have written this, A should actually be dependent on temperature because A is given by this integral. But I am claiming that theta d is the Debye energy scale. Let me come to how do we find this Debye energy scale in a little bit. Okay. But theta d is a Debye energy scale, but it's a fixed number, right? So I can always choose the temperature to be much smaller than theta d because it's a fixed number. And the temperature scale, this entire expression will be valid only when the temperature that I am measuring the specific heat at is much smaller than the Debye energy scale. Okay. So this is an okay assumption. But the question is that if theta d by t is very, very large, right, can this integral give me a divergent contribution when x becomes extremely large? So that's a question. Okay. So what we are saying is, let's break this integral into two parts, 0 to infinity, okay, dx, x to the power 4, e to the power x by e to the power x minus 1 whole squared, minus integral theta d by t to infinity, dx, x to the power 4, e to the power x by e to the power x minus 1 whole squared, okay. So if I break this integral into two parts, what we are saying is, this is what we will consider and this part we will throw away, right? So can somebody tell me what is the justification for throwing away this part? Any guesses?
I think it will be possible when the contribution from the second part is much, much lower than the first part.
Exactly. So can you argue, looking at the integrand, that the contribution is definitely going to be much smaller compared to the first part? So let me give you a hint. So you're going in the right direction. The hint is that theta d by t is much greater than 1. Okay. And for concreteness, let's assume that we are at a temperature which is 100th of the Debye scale. Okay. So let's assume that this number theta d by t is 100. Okay. So this limit here, let's say this is 100 and the upper limit is infinity. And I want you to argue that this is extremely small. So can you argue that?
There is an extra contribution from 0 to 100 in the first part, which is not in the second part. So it's quite obvious that first part will be much larger than the second part.
Oh, no. It's not obvious at all. Because see, suppose I take this integral. Okay. Let's take another integral, 0 to infinity x squared. Okay. And then do exactly the same thing, 100 to infinity x squared. Fine?
Yes.
So now can you tell me, is this negligible? Remember, this is
no.
An increasing function, right? This is not negligible, isn't it? Because when x becomes larger, the x squared becomes even larger.
Right? So there yes. may be some exponential minus function. So,
yes, that is exactly what I want you to
argue. It can decay because e to the power x minus 1, e to the power x will be very greater than 1. Then e to the power 2x in upper direction, it will give e to the power minus x to the power 4 dx.
Okay.
So, this is exponentially decay function. And as we increase x, the decay function will decrease much faster. So, it will give nothing.
Very good. Okay. Yeah. So, that's... That's the argument. So basically what we are saying here is that if we look at this function, okay, remember this function goes from 100 to infinity. Now, which means that all the x values that I need to consider in this integrand will be between 100 and infinity. Okay, so then let's take this e to the power x. Now, e to the power 100 is going to be much bigger than 1, which means that e to the power x minus 1 is roughly e to the power x itself. And this whole thing becomes x to the power 4 e to the power minus x, because there is a e to the power 2x and there is a e to the power x here. And even though the x to the power 4 increases rapidly, e to the power minus x decreases much more rapidly. Okay, so this will be 100 to the power 4 times e to the power minus 100. Okay, so this is going to be extremely, extremely, extremely small. Okay, in fact, it tends to 0. Right, so every single term in this integrand tends to 0. Right, and as you increase the x, the integrand decreases exponentially. Okay, so what you can do is you can, in your spare time, you can approximate this integrand as this, which is exactly doable, okay? And doing this integral, you can actually figure out what is the temperature dependence that you have thrown away, okay? And you will see that the temperature dependence you have thrown away is actually exponentially small, okay? So, given this whole thing, what we will do is, we will keep only this term, right? And this whole thing, let's take the A to be a constant. To remove this, sorry, this is a little bit slow process. Okay, yeah, so this tells us that CV is proportional to TQ, right? And this is the famous phonon contribution to specific heat. Now, this phonon contribution, remember, is the acoustic phonon contribution. But this is not the optical phonon contribution, okay? So, let's do the same calculation now for optical phonons, okay? But for optical phonons, what we will do is we will make another approximation, which is that omega ks is a single frequency omega naught for all k, right? So, this is like the Einstein approximation. So the first one for acoustic phonons was the Debye approximation, and now we are making the Einstein approximation, which means that the optical phonon has this dispersion, but we are now saying that this is what we are doing. Okay? We will consider only one frequency omega naught, right? And if we do that, then what happens to the integral? Will there be an integral left? So let's go back to that expression, which was on that. So CV is basically 1 over KBT squared. And let's call this optical. Okay, 1 over KBT squared, 1 over V. And then there was a sum over K, H cross omega and omega K whole squared, e to the power beta h cross omega k divided by e to the power beta h cross omega k minus 1 whole square. So if I make the Einstein approximation, that is omega k is the same for all k, then what happens to this sum over k?
There will be no sum.
The sum vanishes,
right? In fact, the sum does not exactly vanish. You will just be summing over some constant, because omega k we will be replacing by omega naught, right? So this whole thing becomes a constant. It comes out of the summation, and all we are doing is that we are counting the number of modes, right? In the optical branch, we will be counting how many modes are present, okay? So essentially, this becomes 1 over kbt squared h cross omega naught whole squared by v e to the power beta h cross omega naught divided by e to the power beta h cross omega naught minus 1 whole squared times sum over k. Okay, now this sum over k is only over is on 1, which means we have to find out how many modes are present in the optical branch. So what is the answer for this?
N modes.
N modes, right? Where N is the number of sites in the lattice. Correct? Very nice. So this is N. Okay. And so given this answer, let me, I will have to erase this part. So the CV then becomes N by V H cross omega naught squared by KBT squared e to the power H cross omega naught by KBT over e to the power beta, sorry, H cross omega naught by KBT minus 1 whole squared. So for this, we can actually find out low temperature limit by taking KBT to be much smaller than the Einstein frequency H cross omega naught, right? So this is certainly a viable lower low temperature limit. And if we take this limit, then you can see that the e to the power H cross omega naught by KBT is going to be a very large number. So the minus one can actually be neglected. And this whole thing then becomes N by V, okay, H cross omega naught whole squared by KBT squared times e to the power minus h cross omega naught by KBT. Okay, so this is the optical branch contribution at low temperature. Remember, optical branch contribution. So this is what we were expecting, that if the temperature is extremely small compared to this omega naught scale, so let's say the temperature is at this scale, then the contribution to the specific heat of the optical branch is going to be exponentially small. Okay, so but is this actually true? Because I'm asking, because if I take this T squared, then 1 over T squared is going to infinity, right? When T goes to 0, then 1 over T squared goes to infinity. So is this actually exponential? So will the exponential win or will the polynomial win? Do you see my question? See, when t tends to 0, 1 over t squared goes to infinity. So the CV should actually diverge if I consider only the polynomial part. But if I look at the exponential part, then the CV goes to 0. So which one will win? Will the exponential win or will the 1 by t squared win?
Exponential.
Exponential will win, right? The exponential always increases much more rapidly than any other polynomial. Okay? And if I plot the CV as a function of temperature, then what you would see is actually like this, something like this. Okay? And this is the exponential decay as a function of temperature. Okay? Whereas if you look at the phonon contribution from the acoustic branch, then that would look something like this. That would also look something similar, okay, but it will start increasing a bit rapidly, right? So remember, t cube or x cube, if I plot, then x cube also has an inflection point, right? But the exponential actually is like this. So this is the optical branch and this is the acoustic branch, right? So by looking at the low temperature specific heat and then figuring out, or you know, adding these two contributions, then one can figure out what is the contribution from the optical branch, what is the contribution from the acoustic branch. But then in any real,
sir, when we apply heat of very small amount of energy, then is the optical and acoustical branches graphs are on same scaling?
Because, no, absolutely not. No.
Okay.
They are
okay,
not. Okay, they are not. The exponential contribution from the optical branch will really, you know, be suppressed.
Small. Optical is very small. Okay.
Yeah. In fact, the more dominant contribution is from the free electrons, right? So, in the next unit, when we do the free electron theory, then we will see that the CV is actually proportional to the temperature. At low temperature for the electrons. So, in reality, what will happen when you supply heat at very low temperatures is that the electrons will absorb the maximum amount of heat. Okay, and the phonons are next. But then this changes as you go to higher temperature.
Okay, sir. Sir, when we apply heat of energy comparable to the energy of the optical zone, so in that extent, will the what will be the prominent, acoustical or optical, or it will be depending on the which temperature we are looking for?
Yes. So if you are at a temperature which is let's say of the order of the optical frequency. Okay. So let me do the following. Let's take this optical branch, this acoustic branch, right? And say that you are at a temperature which is somewhere here. Okay. This is your temperature. Now, obviously, your temperature is higher than all the acoustic phonons, correct? So, you can see the, can you see the mouse?
Yes, sir.
Can you see
yes,
the cursor? Sir. Okay. So, you can see that the temperature is higher than all the frequencies of the acoustic branch, correct? See, this is the temperature and this is the acoustic branch and this is omega k. So we are at a temperature which is in the or which is cutting the optical branch, and it's much higher than the acoustic branch, which means that you will be exciting all the acoustic modes first of all, and you will be exciting a part of the optical modes, right? The other part, which is higher than the temperature, is not going to be excited, for example, in a linear way. Okay? It's probably going to be again exponential. But this is a quantitative question. Okay? So you will really have to do the integral and then figure out what is the full temperature dependence. Okay.
Then and we have to add.
Yeah.
Add the contribution of acoustical and optical.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely. Okay. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. All right. So, I was saying something. I forgot. Okay. But mainly the dispersion actually matters a lot. And what we have done here is a very simple calculation, because we have taken the Einstein approximation. We have taken the dispersion of the optical branch also to be negligible, which means that the omega k dependence, we assume that omega k was just equal to omega naught, right? In reality, you would have to take this dispersion also and then compute what is the total contribution to specific heat, right? And this is only for 1D. Now, if you consider a higher dimensional object, then you would have more complicated contributions.
Right? Sir, I have another question, a little bit different from this topic, but related to it. So, you told me about that phase transition, but when phase transition occurs, the elements or exciton particles are changed. So, there are many phonons. But when we change the system, and the modes will change. So the discontinuity in CV versus T graph, comes from this, the dispersion relation or the changing of excitons or something like that.
So the thing is, let's say we talk about some structural phase transition. Okay. So usually a structural phase transition is always first order in nature. Right, there are very, very few structural phase transitions which are actually continuous. So we are talking about the crystal changing its Bravais lattice. Okay, so in that sense, what happens is that the dispersion changes very drastically. This is something that we had discussed long ago. Okay, the dispersion actually changes as you are changing the conditions. For example, you could consider a pressure-induced structural phase transition. Okay, so under pressure, a certain material undergoes a different or goes through a phase transition and assumes a different crystal structure. So that happens in many systems, and when that happens, obviously the dispersion of the phonons is going to change drastically. Okay, so as the dispersion is changing, you would have to calculate the specific heat contribution from that changing dispersion. Okay, so what I mean is that let's say this is the pressure axis, okay? And if this is the pressure axis, then at each point on the pressure axis, you would be computing the dispersion, Okay, and given that dispersion, you will calculate what is the specific heat, right? And exactly at the phase transition, right? Then here the exactly at the phase transition or the critical pressure, you would not know what the dispersion is. In fact, it turns out that at this phase transition, some of the modes might go soft. Some of the modes become soft, which means that the original crystal structure, which you were, you know, which was there at low pressures, becomes unstable. Why is that? Because if some of the modes become soft, which means that some of the modes, the energy of corresponding to those modes becomes zero. Okay, it means that there is zero energy required to excite that particular mode. Okay, so what I'm saying is that imagine that this is the acoustic branch, okay, and there is a cone anomaly that develops, but it is so extreme that the dispersion happens to be like this. Okay, then at this k vector, you can see that there are modes in the system which take zero energy to excite. Okay, and that is what leads to an instability, and then the system assumes a different crystal structure where there are no modes which are at zero energy except the acoustic modes. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. But it's a very important question. One has to really, you know, phase transitions is something that are very, very important. There are a lot of technological applications. There is a lot of basic physics in it. And to understand the phonon dispersions as you go through phase transitions is an extremely important and difficult problem. Okay. So do read some of Professor Umesh Vaghmare's papers. He actually works on this problem. He works on interfacing first principles calculations, starting from density functional theory, to the Landau phase transition theory. Okay, so if you look at Landau phase transition theory, you can write the free energy as a Taylor's expansion of the order parameter. Okay, but the coefficients in the Taylor's expansion, he gets it from density functional theory, and then goes on to do the Landau theory and get the phase transition temperatures and so on. Okay, so do look up some of his papers or talk to some of his students and you will understand what we are talking about. Is that okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Other questions?
Sir?
Yes?
I didn't understand why they are taking Einstein's block equation.
You did not understand the Einstein's approximation?
No, why we are taking it, like justification of it.
Why we are taking it to be dispersionless?
Yeah.
Okay. So, see the way I have drawn it here, okay, let me just remove this. Okay, so, see the way we draw it is like this, okay, this is linear here, and the way we have drawn it here is like this. Okay, now remember this is omega k, and this is k. So let's say this is pi by a. Now what we are saying is this we know. This is sine ka by 2. Okay. But this part is actually much more complicated. If you look at the expression for omega k for the optical branch, it's a bit more complicated, right? So what we will do is, see, you can see that the omega k for this is restricted to within this window. Okay, this is for the optical branch, this is omega k max, and this one is omega k min. And the omega k max and omega k min are not too different. Okay, so all we are saying is, let's make an approximation that all the modes in the optical branch have only one frequency, which is omega naught. Okay, now in reality, as we have already discussed, this is a crude approximation. There is actually a dispersion relation for the optical branch also, okay? But as an approximation, like we did the linear approximation for the acoustic branch, which is also not correct, it becomes non-linear here near the Brillouin zone edge, right? But it gives us a qualitative feeling for what the specific heat looks like, okay? So in the same way, if you want to get a qualitative answer, you make certain approximations and get the qualitative answer, and then you start refining. So the first approximation to doing the optic for getting the contribution from the optical branch is that you do a Taylor's expansion. Okay. So if you take omega k for the optical branch, right, then what you can do is you can write it as some omega naught plus something times k plus something times k squared and so on. Okay. So in this spirit, we have taken the zeroth order contribution and then looked at the specific heat contribution only from this. Does that make sense?
Okay, I got it.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Okay.
I got it.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So, we can do one thing, which is we can find out what is the Debye scale. Okay. So we have assumed that there is a certain Debye scale in the system, but we don't know how to find it. Okay. So can somebody tell me how to find the Debye scale? What could we use to find the Debye scale?
Can we use the total number of modes?
Yeah, you know the answer. Good. Okay. So what we will do is, we will find out what is the total number of modes in the system, and from that find out the Debye scale. Okay. So to find that out, let's do the following. So let's say the total number of modes is again 4 pi k d cube by 3. The total number of modes we know, right? In this is the number of modes in the acoustic branch. Okay. And this is given by, this is the total volume, okay, of the sphere in k space, and then 2 pi q by v. This is in three dimensions. Okay. So if we look at this, then it turns out n is k d cube by 6 pi squared, right? And from here we can see that k b theta d is h cross c k d. Okay, so remember we have taken a linear dispersion, which is why this is h cross c k d. And if you now put in the numbers from here, then you will see that theta d is roughly 400 kelvin. Okay, so this is a rough number, and this works out close to this. Okay, so many solids do have Debye temperatures of the order of a few hundred kelvin, which means that if you are at a temperature which is much smaller than a few hundred kelvin, then the T cube approximation is very good. Okay, and I would encourage you to look up the books by Kittel and the other book by Ibach and Luth. There are many real material systems for which they have shown the dispersion relations. Okay, and from that you can appreciate how many branches arise. Okay, what is the dispersion of the branches? So that is something that I might base a question on, right? Actually, we should be discussing some test date also. There is a midterm test that we have to hold at some point. Okay, and we should discuss some test date also. Yeah, but anyway, just keep that in mind. Okay. Maybe sometime in the last week of October or something, we'll have a small midterm test. So this is the rough order of magnitude of the Debye temperature. Okay, so this is something that you must remember. Few hundred Kelvin, right? And so there are some things that you must always remember when you finish the course, right? And this is one of those things. That if somebody asks you what is the Debye scale, right, you should be immediately able to say that it's of the order of a few hundred Kelvin, right? And the significance of the Debye temperature scale is that all the will get excited once you go beyond the Debye scale, right? Only when you are at a temperature which is much below the Debye scale, you are only exciting a part of the acoustic branch. But if you are much above the Debye temperature, then all of the acoustic modes are getting excited, which means that the entire acoustic branch is going to give you a constant in specific heat. Okay, and you might be in the optical branch limit. If your temperature is even beyond the optical branch limit, then all the optical modes are also getting excited, and you will get a constant contribution from the optical branch also. Okay, so remember that the temperature at which you are determines which modes will contribute. If your temperature is cutting the acoustic branch, only a part of the acoustic branch will contribute. If your temperature is much above the acoustic branch, which means much above the Debye temperature, then all the acoustic modes will contribute. Okay. So this is the qualitative meaning of the Debye temperature. Okay. And it signifies the crossover from a temperature dependent specific heat to a temperature independent specific heat, right? Coming from the acoustic branch. All right. So there are a few more concepts related to the density of states and everything, but that I will do when we come to the electrons part. Let's do a simple calculation of thermal expansion. Okay. And we will see why the harmonic approximation is always gives you no thermal expansion. Okay. So the claim is that a harmonic approximation, which is what we have been doing until now, okay, harmonic approximation implies no thermal expansion. Okay, so which means that we have to bring in anharmonicity if we want to consider thermal expansion. Okay. Now, what is the meaning of this, right? So let's look at a certain potential function, right, and make it anharmonic. So let's say u of x is some c x squared minus g times x cubed minus f times x to the power 4. Okay, so I'm saying consider this. This is just the harmonic part. So this is cubic and this is quartic. Okay, and if you plot this, then you should get at low x, what you should get is something like this. If this was pure x squared, then it would be like this. But because of the x cube, you will actually see something like this. Okay, it's not going to be symmetric anymore, right? So these two, this is asymmetric about x is equal to 0. So I'm again plotting here u of x versus x. Okay. So because of this asymmetry, what you will see is that the expectation value of the x itself, okay, will be proportional to the temperature.
Sir, will the f be negative?
What is f? Oh, the quartic part. No.
Yes.
See, it has to be positive in some sense. See, what we are saying essentially is that this is not an expression which is valid for extremely large x. Okay. So there are many things which are implicit here and have not been said explicitly. You're absolutely right. If f was negative or positive, it makes a very large difference at large x. Isn't that what you're pointing out?
Yes, exactly.
Right? Yeah. And it will not be a confining potential if f is negative. If f is positive. Yeah. So if f is positive, then at large x, it will basically go to minus infinity and the particle will just run away, right? At large x. But obviously f has to be negative in order for this to be a confining potential. But in any case, this entire expression here, okay, the g and f have to be much smaller than 1 for the entire thing to be convergent. And these should be considered as very small corrections to the harmonic part. Okay, so in that sense, the sign of this really doesn't matter because you're not going to be using this entire expression for large x. Okay, and in any case, if you consider this as a solid, then remember, even the harmonic approximation is giving you some amplitude of vibration. So you will always be able to find out what is average value of the x squared. And if you find that the average value of x squared is it becomes of the order of the lattice parameter itself, okay, so then that signifies melting. So even from the harmonic approximation, you can actually get an idea of what is the melting temperature, right? But thermal expansion is something that you cannot describe using the harmonic approximation. Okay? The reason is, for thermal expansion, you should have the equilibrium position itself to be changed. Okay, so what we mean is that let's say this is a solid at equilibrium at some temperature. Okay, now when we increase the temperature, we believe that this system should expand, right? But what does expansion mean? Expansion means that it should look something like this. Its lattice parameter should have increased. Okay, now what that means is that the equilibrium position of each of these atoms has actually changed. Okay, and each of these is equilibrating or oscillating about its equilibrium position, right? Here also this is oscillating, right? This is at some temperature T1, this is at some temperature T2, and T1 is smaller than T2. Okay, but what has happened is that at T1 the equilibrium position was something, and now the equilibrium position has changed. Okay, which means that the equilibrium position is actually dependent on temperature. Now this is a result which is what is needed to explain thermal expansion, that the expectation value of the x itself should be dependent on temperature. Okay, but under the harmonic approximation, if the potential is pure x squared, then you can see that the expectation value of x is always going to be zero, because the potential is an even function. So if the potential is a pure even function, the particle will basically oscillate and come back to zero. Okay, only when the potential is asymmetric that you will find the expectation value of x to be non-zero, which is what the cubic term is doing. Okay, so the cubic term is essential in understanding thermal expansion, or in other words, anharmonicity is extremely important if you understand a concept as simple as thermal expansion. Okay,
So if the cubic term can give us the anharmonicity, then what is the quartic term doing here?
Okay, so in many situations you will find that the quartic term is not very small compared to the cubic term. Okay, so in many situations you would have to take into account quartic terms. Okay, let me say one more thing. See, we have considered a solid where there are n normal modes for each branch. Okay, and as Disha was saying that she found some interaction between the acoustic branch and the optical branch, which should not have happened at the harmonic level, but if you bring in anharmonicity, you will actually see a mixing of the branches. You will also see a scattering of phonons against other phonons. Okay, and these terms here will signify the strength of that scattering. Okay, so this term will give you a 3-phonon scattering, this term will give you a 4-phonon scattering. Okay, and it's not clear a priori that the 3-phonon scattering term will always dominate the 4-phonon scattering term. Okay, so in fact there is a person who might have joined this class. His name is Prasad. He is actually working on the phonon scattering mechanisms. Okay, and he does actually calculate these parameters, the F and the G. And next time I will ask him to join, and maybe he can inform us about the actual numbers that he gets for the G and F. And he does find that the 4-phonon scattering mechanism is actually important for understanding certain phenomena. Okay. So his full name is Prasad. Okay, his name is Prasad. He works with Professor Umesh Vaghmare. He's a postdoc. Okay, so let me ask him to give us these numbers. Okay. Is that okay?
Okay, sir.
All right, so basically what we are saying is that for understanding thermal expansion, the average value of x should not be zero. It should actually be dependent on temperature. Okay, so this is essential, and this is what we will find when we use the cubic term. Okay, so let's see how this works. What we have to do is we have to find out the expectation value of x, which is just equal to integral x e to the power minus beta u of x, okay, dx, divided by integral e to the power minus beta u of x. All right, so now the u of x is something that you can write it as u naught of x plus u anharmonic of x. All right, and what we will do here is that we will replace the u of x by this splitting the u naught, which is the harmonic part. So let's say this is the harmonic part, and this is the enharmonic part. Okay, and then we can do a Taylor's expansion, e to the power minus beta u naught x times 1 minus beta u n harmonic of x dx. And here we can just keep the u naught of x. In fact, even if you keep the corrections, they will turn out to be subdominant. Okay? These are subdominant corrections, so they don't need to be considered here. Now you can take this u anharmonic, okay, substitute the x cube in x to the power 4, right? And if you substitute that here, you will see that the x cube term will actually contribute. The x to the power 4 term will not contribute, right? Because the x cube term, when you multiply it to this, it will become x to the power 4. And this is anyway an even function, right? And there is also a temperature which is sitting here, right? So this, if you compute this, right, then you will actually find that this is proportional to temperature. Okay. So what this is telling us is that the expectation value of x is actually proportional to temperature only because there is a cubic term which is sitting here. Okay? And that cubic term is leading to this linear increase in the equilibrium position of the atom. Okay? And the coefficient of proportionality will basically be the coefficient of thermal expansion. Right? So by knowing what the cubic term is, you can actually figure out what is the coefficient of thermal expansion of a solid. So it's that important. Okay. And okay, so what we will do is we will do a little bit of Raman scattering in the next class, right? But today we will finish the class here. Okay, and if there are any more questions, I can take them. And I think there is one more topic called thermionic emission or something like that. Let me, in any case, if there are any questions, then let me know now. No questions?
Sir, can I rephrase the question again?
Yeah, go ahead.
Actually, I know that for calculating the expectation value of x, there will be no effect of that quartic term. So I wanted to know that are we taking the quartic term for thermal expansion?
Got it.
Not for any other.
Okay. Yeah, for thermal expansion, you're absolutely right that it is not contributing at all. Okay, you're right. But there are many phenomena that we have not considered where this thermal expansion actually becomes the quartic term does become important. Okay, so one simple thing is, for example, let's say you are considering thermoelectrics. Okay, in thermoelectrics, if you might have heard various talks in JNC, there is something called a figure of merit that you have to find out. Okay, there is a figure of merit. Right, and that figure of merit is actually proportional to the or inversely proportional to the thermal conductivity. Okay, now this thermal conductivity has two parts: the thermal conductivity of phonons plus thermal conductivity of electrons. Okay, now before I get into this, the answer to your question is definitely for thermal expansion the quartic term is not contributing. Okay, but now I am going over to where could it be important. Okay. Now, if you see here, the thermal conductivity is actually coming from two parts. One is the electron part and one is the phonon part, which means the first thing that you talked about, the thermal conduction. Okay, when you supply heat, then the heat is transferred or the heat is carried from one part to the other part, and that is the process of thermal conduction. So now here you find that there are two parts. One is the electron part and one is the phonon part. The phonons also carry heat. The electrons will also carry heat. Now, if there was no resistance to electrons, if there was no scattering of electrons, then the motion of electrons is called ballistic. Okay, and ballistic conduction is extremely efficient, right? Because it will carry heat without any resistance. Now, the same thing for phonons. If they were completely harmonic, right? If pure harmonicity was present in the system, the phonons would carry heat ballistically, because they would be completely non-interacting. Okay, it's only the enharmonicity which brings about a scattering of the phonons against each other and gives resistance to the phonon system, phonon subsystem. Okay, and in that case, apparently the quartic term actually contributes more than the cubic term in some cases. Okay, so this is one specific case where the phonon-phonon scattering becomes extremely important, and the quartic term is the term that actually contributes more than the cubic term in some cases. Okay, so does that answer the question?
Yes, sir.
So in fact, Prasad is doing some calculation where he looks at the contribution of the specific terms and then figures out what is the contribution to the thermal conductivity. Okay, so we will ask him to join and give, let's say, a 5-minute introduction to the subject.
Okay, sir.
But you're right, for thermal expansion, it's not important. Any other question? No? Okay. So, yeah, then see you on Wednesday. We will try to have another class, but let's see, if it is needed, we will have another class to cover up for the for yesterday's class. Okay, but if it is not needed, we will not do it. Let's see. Okay, see you guys.
Thank you.